Welcome back, everyone. This will be a continuation into our look into forensic science. This will be Chapter 15, Forensic Serology. Now, getting into the nature of blood, plasma, which is the fluid portion of blood, is composed principally of water and accounts for 55% of blood content. Red blood cells, known as erythrocytes, white blood cells, leukocytes, and platelets are the solid materials suspended in blood plasma. Antigens are located on the surface of red blood cells and are responsible for blood type characteristics. Antigens stimulate the body to produce antibodies against it. Plasma contains proteins known as antibodies. The fundamental principle of blood typing is that for every antigen, there exists a specific antibody. Antibodies are normally bivalent, that is, they have two reactive sites. This means that an antibody can attach to antigens located on two red blood cells, forming a network of cross-linked cells. Seen as clumping or agglutination. Agglutination of blood cells, as seen here, red blood cells on the left containing A antigens do not combine with B antibodies. Red blood cells containing B antigens are agglutinated or clumped together in the presence of B antibodies. More than 15 blood antigen systems had been identified, but the ABO and RH systems are the most common or most important. An individual whose blood type is type A has A antigens on his or her red blood cells. Type B blood type will have B antigens in them, and type AB has both A and B antigens. Whereas blood type O has neither A nor B antigens in their blood, owing to why people with AB blood type can receive blood donations, blood transfers from anyone, while people who have O blood type can donate their blood to anyone because they do not have the antigens that would react with type A or type B. Approximately 43% of the population is type O, 42% is type A, 12% is type B, and 3% is type AB. This varies from different countries and different populations, but for average, most likely average for the US. Regarding antibodies, type A blood has only anti-B antibodies and no anti-A. It does not have antigens against itself. Type B blood has only anti-A antigens. Type AB blood has neither anti-A or anti-B antigens, whereas type O has both anti-A and anti-B antigens. Type O individuals cannot receive blood transfers from type A or type B people, but type AB people can. Blood typing, RH factor is determined by the presence of another antigen, the D antigen. People having the D antigen are Rh positive. Those not having the antigen are Rh negative. Hence, people who are negative can donate to other negative or other positives, but people who are positive can only donate to positives. People who are O negative can donate to anyone. People who are O positive can donate to anyone who's also positive. A blood type test for types A, B, AB, and O, shown here. Different ways to find out which, when adding different solutions, which reacts to the chemical addition that shows a reaction, whether or not antigens are present or not. An immunoassay. The concept of specific antigen-antibody reactions has been applied to immunoassay techniques for detecting drugs of abuse in blood and urine. Antibodies that react with drugs do not usually exist naturally. However, They can be absorbed produced in animals by combining the drug with a protein and injecting this combination into the animal, where the body will naturally form those antigens, stimulating production of drug antibodies. A drug is introduced with a protein carrier. Our animal bodies are very good at detecting when there's a foreign protein substance, and because the drug is attached with it, antigens will be formed against both. Antigen antibody reactions. When an animal, such as a rabbit or mouse, is injected with an antigen, its body will produce a series of different antibodies, all of which are designed to attack some particular site of the antigen of interest. Those antibodies are known as polyclonal antibodies. Alternately, a more uniform and specific collection of antibodies designed to combine with a single antigen site may be manufactured. Such antibodies are known as monoclonal antibodies. Here are the steps required to produce monoclonal antibodies. The antigen is injected, and then a mouse or rabbit with the antigen. The immune system will form antibodies. The spleen cells remove the spleen and isolate spleen cells, which produce antibodies to the antigen of interest. Malignant blood cells with the spleen cell fuse spleen cells with malignant cells, which grow well in a cell culture, so to help continue growing that cell structure when it's outside of the animal. Hybridoma cells can then form. Grow, step four, grow hybrid cells and isolate ones that produce the antibody of interest. Culture the hybrid cells to create a virtually limitless supply of antibodies. And that's how we get the monoclonal antibodies. A number of immunological assay techniques are commercially available for detecting drugs through antigen antibody reactions. Toxicologists use the enzyme multiplied immunoassay technique, EMIT, because it's of its speed and a high sensitivity for detecting drugs and urine. In a typical EMIT analysis, antibodies that will bind to a specific drug are added to a subject's urine. This is followed by adding a chemically labeled version of the drug to the urine. A competition will ensue between the labeled and unlabeled drug to bind with the antibody. In the EMIT assay, a drug that may be present in a urine specimen will compete with added labeled drugs for a limited number of antibody binding sites. The labeled drugs are indicated by an asterisk. Once the competition for antibody sites is completed, the number of remaining unbound labeled drug is proportional to the drug's concentration in urine. Here at the top, we see we have an antibody and then a labeled drug that's mixed with a sample. No drug present in the urine means that all of those labeled drugs were able to bind to antigen sites, whereas in the monocyte, if we have drugs that have a radioactive label that can easily be measured, is mixed with a sample that already has that drug, but the unradioactive version, then, or the version that's not fluorescent, whichever the study uses, only some fluorescence will still be present, or some of the labeled antigen will still be measurable because some of the binding sites on the antigen sites were able to bind to the actual natural drug. Forensics of blood. The criminalist must be prepared to answer the following questions when examining dried blood. Is it blood? From what species did the blood originate? Is the blood of human origin? And if so, how closely can it be associated to a particular individual? blood color tests, the determination of blood begins by means of a preliminary color test. A positive result from a Castle-Meier color test is highly indicative of blood. Hemoglobin reacts with the Castle-Meier reagent to produce a deep pink color. Alternatively, the luminol test or blue star test are used to search out trace amounts of blood located at crime scenes. These tests produce light luminescence in a darkened area. The luminol is extremely sensitive and is capable of detecting blood that has been diluted up to 100,000 times. Blood origin testing. Once the stain has been characterized as blood, the precipitin test will determine whether the stain is of human or animal or other animal origin. The precipitin test uses anti-sera, normally derived from rabbits, that has been injected with the blood of a known animal to determine the species origin of a questioned blood stain. The technique of gel diffusion takes advantage of the fact that antibodies and antigens diffuse or move toward one another on an agar plate. The extracted blood stain and the human anti-serum are placed in separate holes opposite each other on the gel. If the blood is human, a line of precipitation forms where the antigens and antibodies meet. Alternatively, some confirmatory tests of blood are human-specific, and the precipitin test does not need to be performed. Showing the precipitin test withdrawing blood from a human vein, blood injected into a rabbit, blood serum sensitized to human blood is removed from the rabbit. So the rabbit has antibodies or antigens for human blood. Human blood gives a precipitin ban with sensitized rabbit serum. So rabbit serum taken out, and when mixed with human blood, if it is human blood, it already has antigens and antibodies against human blood. Hence a line of precipitation or coagulation between where the two mix. Antigens and antibodies moving toward one another under the influence of an electrical potential, or in our words, electrical potential just means a voltage. Antigen and antibody are added to their respective wells, to their different openings on a gel. Antigen and antibody move toward each other as a voltage is applied on the gel. Antigen and antibody have formed a visible precipitin line in the gel well, in the gel between the wells. Individualizing blood stains. Once confirmed that the blood stain is of human origin, an effort must be made to associate or dissociate the stain with a particular individual. DNA analysis has allowed forensic scientists to associate blood to a single individual. Genes and chromosomes. The gene is the basic unit of heredity. A chromosome is a thread-like structure in the cell nucleus, along where the genes are located. Each gene is actually composed of DNA specifically designed to carry out the task of controlling the genetic traits of our cells. The position of a gene occupies on a chromosome and is known as a locus. Approximately 30,000 human genes have been identified. Most human cells contain 46 chromosomes arranged in 23 mated pairs. The only exceptions are the human reproductive cells, the egg and sperm, which contain 23 unmated chromosomes. This is so that once a if an egg cell and a sperm cell have half the genetic genome needed to make a whole human, once the egg and sperm combine, then you have all the genetic material used to make a person. If the egg and sperm each had 46 chromosomes, then when they would combine, that would be 92 chromosomes, which is more than what's necessary to make a human and could lead to disastrous effects. So most cells have the entire genome to make a person. The sex cells only have half the genetic material needed to make a person so that they can combine together to make a whole person. During fertilization, a sperm and an egg combine so that each contributes 23 chromosomes to form the new cell or zygote that develops into the offspring. An allele is any of several alternative forms of genes at a particular locus and that are aligned with one another on a chromosome pair. A heterozygous gene pair is made up of two different alleles. A homozygous gene pair is made up of two identical alleles. When two different genes are inherited, the characteristic coded for by the dominant gene is what will be visible or what will be expressed. The characteristic code coded for by a recessive gene will remain hidden unless only the recessive gene was inherited twice. For example, for the genes that encode for brown eyes, if they are inherited from one parent, and genes encoding for blue eyes are inherited by another parent, the child will have brown eyes because brown is a dominant allele over blue. But if a child inherits blue alleles from both the mother and father, from both parents, then that child will have blue eyes. Heredity and paternity. Hereditary material is transmitted by means of microscopic cells called genes located on chromosomes, alternative forms of genes that influence a given characteristic, such as eye color or blood type, are known as alleles. Paternity testing has historically involved the ABO blood typing system, along with blood factors other than ABO. Currently, paternity testing has implemented DNA test procedures that can raise the odds of establishing paternity beyond 99% accuracy. Testing for seminal stains. Many of the cases sent to a forensic laboratory involve sexual offenses, making it necessary to examine evidence for the presence of seminal stains. The best way to locate and at the same time characterize a seminal stain is to perform the acid phosphatase color test, an enzyme secreted into seminal fluid. A purple color indicates the presence of acid phosphatase enzyme. Semen can be specifically identified by the presence of spermatozoa or by P30, a protein present in seminal plasma. Forensic scientists can successfully link seminal material to an individual by DNA typing. Sexual assault evidence. The sexual assault victim must undergo a medical examination as soon as possible after the assault. At the time, the appropriate items of physical evidence are collected: pubic combings, pubic hair control, 25 hairs at least, external genital swabs, vaginal swabs, and cervix swabs. An additional rectal swabs, swabs of body areas such as breasts, oral swabs, head hairs, again 25 samples at least, blood sample, buccal swab, fingernail scrapings, urine specimens, and all clothing. All outer and undergarments should be carefully removed and packaged separately in paper, not plastic bags. Bedding or the object upon which the assault took place may also be carefully collected. Rape evidence. If a suspect is apprehended within 24 hours of the assault, it may be possible to detect the victim's DNA on the suspect's underwear or on a penile vaginal swab of the suspect. Items routinely collected from the suspect include all clothing, a sample of pubic hair and head hair, penile swabs, and a blood sample of buccal swab for DNA typing. The forceful physical contact between victim and assailant may result in a transfer of such physical evidence of skin cells, blood, semen, saliva, hairs, and fibers. The persistence of seminal constituents in the vagina, sperm with tails, 4 to 6 hours, sperm without the tails, 3 to 6 days, seminal acid phosphatase, that will be less than 48 hours, prostate specific antigens, less than 72 hours. That's how long those materials can survive or be found. Packaging biological evidence. Before collecting biological evidence, it must be photographed and recorded in sketches or thoroughly documented in written notes. Wearing disposable latex gloves while handling the evidence is required. Avoiding packaging biological evidence in plastic or airtight containers because the accumulation of residue moisture could contribute to the growth of DNA destroying bacteria and fungi. Each stained article should be packaged separately in a paper bag or in a well-ventilated box. All biological evidence should be refrigerated or stored in a cool location until delivery to the laboratory. And that concludes this latest chapter in forensic science, specifically chapter 15, Forensic Serology. Glad to have you all. Glad to be around the 22-minute mark. As always, likes and subscriptions are not necessary, but are purely funny to look at. And it is good to have you all in this class. Looking forward to next video, and peace.